The Saints get ready for a Steel Town Showdown. We'll preview Sunday's matchup with Pittsburgh. We'll profile two men who are big reasons for the Saints' success so far. Quarterback Wade Wilson and running back Derek Brown. We'll go one-on-one with offensive coordinator Carl Smith. And we'll tie the knot with tackle Richard Cooper. Say I do to Saints Sideline next.
This is Saints Sideline.
Hello, and thanks for joining us for our off-week version of Saints Sideline. I'm Ed Daniels.
I'm Alexander Lamont. Ed, the Saints have had a week off to take it easy, relax a little bit, heal all those bumps and bruises, but now it's time to get back to business and head to Pittsburgh on Sunday.
Head to Pittsburgh on Sunday. It felt strange to be home on a Sunday. My wife kept looking at me and saying, don't you have a game to go to?
Yeah, she put you out in the yard.
Put me out in the yard. I think she was hoping that I'd go somewhere. But anyhow, the Saints will go off to Pittsburgh on Sunday. And they are the NFL's only unbeaten team after the Chicago Bears beat the Philadelphia Eagles on Sunday. The mood was definitely upbeat at Saints camp this week. The Steelers are next for a team that's on a roll.
Things have gone about as well as anyone could have possibly hoped. The biggest difference between this 5-0 Saints team and the 5-0 team in 91 is the running game. The play up front has been quality stuff, especially from rookie tackle William Roaf, who offensive coordinator Carl Smith describes as spectacular.
I think they're pretty good, and I think I'm just going to keep working hard and we'll be looking for some good things out of us this year. It's early in the season, though, still, so we can't look at the undefeated record right now.
The Saints now look down the barrel at Barry Foster, and the Steeler offense, whose objective is to run the ball down your throat.
The Steelers are very similar to the Saints in the sense that they would love to run the ball if they can. And even if they're having a hard time of it, they're not going to back off on it. So we realize as defense, we have to go into this game and definitely be geared to stopping the run, because they're really going to hurt you with that, and which is going to set up their passing.
Even the prospects of facing Foster couldn't dim the spirits out at Saints camp this week.
It has to start with him, right? You have to tackle Barry Foster, right?
Well, that would probably, be a pretty good idea. To stop him.
You get him down.
or tackling before he gets in the end zone is probably a pretty good idea.
I'll do it.
Because once you tackle him in the end zone, it really doesn't count.
We're playing well. We have an off week. So I think the guys are pretty happy about that. It's going into the season, I knew we wanted to. I felt in my heart that we could be 5-0 at this point. I there wasn't a doubt in my mind that we could be 5-0 at this point. It was just a matter of going out there and doing it. And we've accomplished that. I don't think we're going to settle for that. But at this point in the season, it's a pretty good feeling.
As Ed mentioned, the key to the fast start has been the running game. And the guy carrying the biggest part of the load is rookie Derek Brown. Doug Mouton talked to number 24 about his surprising start.
You're running wild.
Been super. He sees the hole, he gets to the hole, he can make a guy miss in the hole. And he's been a big difference for us.
That's high praise for a rookie who wasn't taken until the fourth round of April's draft. It seems hard to believe now, but 13 running backs were picked before him.
I was very disappointed. I didn't expect to be chosen in the fourth round. I was expecting at least late second, high third, or something like that. I knew what I could do, but it was, I don't think that everyone else really knew, scouts, coaches from other teams. But I'm glad the way it had worked out, being here with the New Orleans Saints. I'm very thrilled to be here and having the opportunity that I've had.
Derek Brown is not surprised with what he's been able to accomplish. He's on a pace to go over 1,200 yards on the year. What he is surprised with is the opportunity.
I am very surprised about the opportunity, because when I first was coming in here, I just expected probably be on a developmental squad or some special teams. But we had some injuries, and which was unfortunate. But I was had the opportunity. I took advantage of that, and that coaches had confidence in me that I can do well, and I learned my material and just put in there, and I just continue to do the best that I can each time I step on the field.
I'm Doug Mouton for Saints Sideline.
Coming up next, we'll get personal with Saints offensive coordinator Carl Smith as we visit the Smiths at home.
And we'll go one-on-one with his quarterback, Wade Wilson. Those stories are next on Saints Sideline. Joe Montana and Steve Berline available. The Saints raised a few eyebrows when they dipped into the free agent market to grab quarterback Wade Wilson. But it hasn't taken Wilson long to quiet his critics.
Here's Wade Wilson. The Saints are driving for the winning three against San Francisco. Wade Wilson is popped by Merton Hanks, trash-talked by Ricky Waters. His response, shove Waters and walk confidently back to business.
They realized that we had the heat on them, and I think that they were just trying to get us intimidated or break our focus, but I've been around long enough to know not to let that happen, and they were just talking trash.
Have you turned the worm on them, you think?
Well, we hope so. You know, I don't think that one game after the success they've had against the Saints, winning one game is certainly not enough, but if we can continue to play well and go out and beat them out in San Francisco, then I think that we're certainly getting on equal ground with them.
I guess from now until then is really kind of a march to that game, right?
It really is, and you know, I think we're capable of winning them all, you know, until we get to the 49er game, but certainly all the teams on the schedule are capable of beating us, so we just got to regain the intensity that we had in the first few games and go back to preparing hard, and there's no reason why we can't win them.
Wade Wilson leading the Saints to the top of the NFC West. They say football is a funny game, and Wilson has to be giggling inside.
Gone from being released, you know, almost a year and a half ago, and this being my third team within the last 12 months, it's been quite a turnaround and quite a bit of a ride the last 12 months, but I'm really happy where I am right now.
The Saints zeroed in on Wade Wilson after he came off the bench as a Falcon and almost beat the Saints last November. It was the 13 TD passes he threw last year that perhaps convinced the Saints Wade Wilson could still play and win.
I've had some good games against the Saints in the past, and they're well aware of what I used to could do, but I think that playing last year definitely showed them that I can still play.
And play error-free. This is Wilson's lone interception of the year. Back in April, when the Falcons courted Bobby Hebert, Falcon quarterback Chris Miller said,
"We've got to bring some other guys in here. You know, they let Wade get out of here, so they kind of got to cover their butts for that deal."
Miller was a prophet.
The guy calling the shots on offense has suddenly become very popular in New Orleans. Carl Smith's offense is clicking. Doug Mouton visits with the Smiths.
They've run it effectively, and they've thrown it effectively. It doesn't get much better than this.
We understand that five isn't going to get us where we want to go, but this is as good a start as we could ask for.
Consider this. Compared to this juncture last season, Carl Smith's offense has scored 60 more points, averaged 77 more yards, and committed 10 fewer turnovers. Things are definitely clicking.
This was not a bad football team offensively. You know, that's the image was because we started out well, it's like, we were lousy and now we're great. You know, it's not true. This football team still has to go through the crunch.
Despite what some people may think, Carl Smith definitely does know what he's doing. There's no way the Saints could have won as many games as they have over the past 8 years if he didn't. Still, the Smiths hear all the criticisms and they just try to take it in stride.
For the most part, you're going to hear that stuff either on the call-in shows where they're talking to somebody on the radio, or you're going to read it in the paper, but they don't do it face-to-face. It's not a personal thing. It's just, this is their team on Sunday, and if they get angry, they're going to vent their anger, and so you know, everybody's got the right to do that. Sometimes it's not nice to hear. You don't like to hear it, but you tune it out and figure that's all part of the deal.
Carl and Diane Smith met back in the mid-70s in Lafayette. Carl spent 5 years as an assistant coach at USL, where Diane was a student. You could check the birthplaces of their three children and get a Smith family travel log. 11-year-old Tracy was born in Texas while Dad coached at Lamar University. 7-year-old Tyler was born in New Jersey while Carl coached the Stars. And 2-year-old Nicholas was born right here in New Orleans.
When I left California, finished my master's and left California, I went to Colorado. And that seemed like a good place to go, to Boulder, Colorado. And about, you know, 10 years later, I wound up in, we were in New Jersey. It's like, that's not what I meant to do when I left California. So I'll tell you what, we were real tickled when Jim got this job and we were able to move back to Louisiana. This is home for us.
They'd like to be here for a while, but you don't get a lot of job security in coaching. Carl Smith likes to keep his long-range goals simple.
I've got the same goals that I had when I was a graduate assistant at Colorado, and that is to do the best job I can and be good to the people around me. And that's the only goal I got.
I'm Doug Mouton for Saints Sideline.
That is.
Coming up next, we'll tie the knot with Saints tackle Richard Cooper. That and more when Saints Sideline continues. Saints players had this past weekend off. Some guys played golf, others went fishing. Richard Cooper spent the weekend taking the biggest step of his life.
Tell me about this day for you.
What about it?
Tell me what this day means to you.
I'm getting married, making a big commitment for life.
My feelings run very deep. He's a good person. He's very sincere. He's kind. And that's why I love him.
I've been single here 28 years. Something I've been looking forward to all my life. I'm pretty sure it's her goal also. So, we unite tonight and go on for the rest of our lives.
Hi. Richard Warren Cooper.
Take you, state her name.
Take you, Karen Renee Johnson.
To be my wife.
To be my wife.
To have and to hold.
To have and to hold.
From this day forward.
From this day forward.
We have plans for after his football career ends. We don't exactly know what they are. We know we want to do something together.
Sickness and in health.
I want to finish getting my law degree. And I think he's going to go back to Tennessee. And we'll probably go into some business together.
This is my solemn vow.
This is my solemn vow.
Now that Karen and Richard have given themselves to each other by solemn vows, with the joining of hands and the giving and receiving of rings, I announce to you that they are husband and wife in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. Those whom God has joined together, let no one put asunder. Amen.
I now present to you Mr. and Mrs. Richard Warren Cooper. And if I don't say this, I'm on the verge. Whoop, daddy.
Good luck to the lovely couple. Richard Cooper and the offensive line will get a boost this week when injured center Joel Hilgenberg returns. On defense, Sam Mills is still out, but his replacement has filled in.
Saints, the off week meant they had a little more time to devote to good causes. Several Saints spent the time treating some underprivileged kids to a movie.
This past week, the Saints sponsored a free movie screening of Rudy, the story of a kid who dreams of playing football for Notre Dame. Youngsters from Boys Town, the YMCA, and the Boys and Girls Clubs got the free passes, and some Saints were there to show them a good time.
I want to show these guys that I'm here for them. I'm not just a New Orleans Saints football player, but I'm also a person that they can talk to and hang out with on an individual basis.
There are a lot of underprivileged kids in the New Orleans area, and I want to come out and show these kids that there's a positive thing, that I can be a positive role model for them and help them, encourage them to do something with their lives.
Coming up next, Buford Jordan will join us to look ahead to the Steelers. And we'll talk Niners and the rest of the NFC West. That's next on Saints Sideline.
It's 5-0 start. Some national press are still skeptical. Here's what they're saying. Paul Attner of the Sporting News writes, "We've seen this before from the Saints, haven't we? The big tease in the big easy. Fast start leads to exalted expectations, only to be followed by a playoff collapse. New Orleans is 5-0 once again among the NFL's elite, sporting a new quarterback, an improved running game, and supposedly improved clubhouse attitude. But let's face it, who's taking the Saints seriously, considering they are the league's most disappointing franchise over the past six seasons? Despite the skepticism, the Sporting News does respect the Saints. In their latest power poll, the Saints are listed as the number one team in football.
This week's opponent, the Pittsburgh Steelers, are 14th in that poll. To talk about the Steelers, we now go on the bench with Buford Jordan. Buford, the Steelers played well this weekend. They beat San Diego 16-3. They scored a touchdown on defense and three field goals. They've won three in a row. They played basically an eight-man front against San Diego and dared them to run the football. The Chargers couldn't. Can they get away with that against the Saints?
I think so. They're going to have to do that and force the Saints to pass if they plan to win. They have a real good defense. They didn't play too well a couple of weeks ago against the Rams, but they've been playing real well the past couple of weeks. And Kevin Green, I think, is a big factor to that.
Okay, let's talk a little bit about Dom Capers, former Saint coach, now defensive coordinator for the Steelers. Basically, the Saints are going to be playing against themselves in that same style of defense.
Basically, they are. I think, Dom Capers, does the same things defensively that they do here with the Saints, and he kind of knows their thinking, so it'll be a good matchup.
Prediction on the game? The Saints are an early three-point favorite.
I think you can. Like I said, the offense of Pittsburgh, they rely a lot on Barry Foster, and if the Saints can shut him down and force O'Donnell to pass, I think the Saints can come out on top with that one.
49ers and Cowboys. How's it look to you?
That's going to be a good game because, the 49ers, after losing that game to the Saints, have, I think they've put their mind to it that they're going to start playing some ball. And I think you're going to see a good game because Dallas has Emmitt back. So you're looking forward to a good game this week.
I think if Dallas wins and the Saints win on Sunday, then the Saints have a three-game lead with 10 to play, and they've got Phoenix and Atlanta coming up. So it's a great spot for the Saints if they can win, right?
It really is, especially with Frisco, because Frisco, I think, would be the biggest team to challenge them in the division. So if they can get up three games on them, I think it'll be real hard for Frisco to catch up.
Okay, we'll see how it all works out, and we'll hold you personally responsible if things don't work out. Buford will be back to talk about the Steelers game and the rematch with the Falcons next week. We're not done here. We'll check out the rest of the NFC next on Saints Sideline.
DMI.
Saints and the rest of the NFC West will play three games, then get another off week. Here are the Saints' next three opponents: the Steelers, the Falcons, and the Cardinals. Three teams with a combined record of 4-11, and the Steelers have three of those victories. Meanwhile, the 49er road is a little tougher. As we mentioned, they travel to the Big D to take on the Dallas Cowboys. Then they host Phoenix and the Rams. Three teams with a combined record of 6-9. Alex, the Saints have opened up as a three-point favorite on the road in Pittsburgh. Looking at the Saints' success against the AFC over the years under Jim Mora, I think the Saints will win the football game.
This is going to be a defensive battle, one everyone should watch very closely. It will kick off at noon on Sunday.
But before then, don't miss Friday Night Football. JT Curtis and I will have all the area's prep football action Friday night at 10:30, right here on WGNO 26. And let this be the first warning. In 2 weeks, Sunday, October 24th, we'll have our first WGNO sports beat of the season. Join me and a panel of local sports writers and sportscasters as we talk Saints football. That's Sunday, October 24th, the week of the Falcons game at 6 o'clock, right here on WGNO 26. I'm Ed Daniels.
I'm Alexander Laurent. We'll see you next week on Saints Sideline.
Good night.